Hi everyone, Aaron here for Zolotech, and today Apple released iOS 14.7 Beta 5. This is available to developers and also public beta testers. They didn't wait very long to release the public beta, so it's out to 14.7 beta testers now as well. Now this came in at a fairly small 312.6 megabytes, that's on my iPhone 12 Pro Max, and it was about 200 to 300 megabytes on the iPhone XR and the iPhone 7 that I have here. Along with this, Apple also released iPadOS 14.7 Beta 5 that I have on the iPad Air 2, along with watchOS 7.6 Beta 5, tvOS 14.7 Beta 5, and macOS Big Sur 11.5 Beta 5. So all of those are out to developers and public beta testers now. Now let's go ahead and take a look at the build number and talk about what's new. So we'll go to Settings, then we'll go down to General, then About. Now you can see the software version number. If we tap on that, it gives us the build number, and you'll see the build number is 18G5063A. We've finally reached the letter A, which means we're very close to a final release. Now, typically with the A at the end, it means we'll probably have a release candidate next. However, they have skipped this before. A release candidate, or RC, which used to be called GM or Golden Master, was the final version that's released to beta testers before it's released to the public. I would expect that very soon. I'll talk about that in a little bit. Now, as far as new updates or changes, the first thing as far as new features is a new modem update. We went from 1.80.01 to 1.80.02 on the iPhone 12 Pro Max. Now, it can vary from device to device with modem updates, but that just means that they're fixing something in the modem, which could improve 5G connectivity or 4G to 5G switching. They don't say specifically what it is, but it could be updated. So that's been updated in this beta. Now, as far as anything else new, well, I did want to mention the international watch bands. I mentioned that last time. This is actually the USA version. There's 22 different ones, and you can see it actually says USA there, and then it has a watch face to go along with it. I mentioned this in the previous beta update video. You can see there was a little bug there, but that's the watch band with the watch face that goes with it. For those of you that are curious, this is the Lumi app with the Infograph modular watch face. So you can see Infograph modular. So that's how you get that, and you can create it yourself if you have that app. Now, as far as new things, well, the first thing I saw, which I only saw on one of these devices when I went into it, let me see if I can bring it up on the iPad, is the first time I went into Reminders, I got another splash screen. So if we go into Reminders, there's a new splash screen, and you can see it says quick creation, easy organization, smarter is better. It was a little bit different on the iPhone though. So if we go onto the iPhone, I took a screenshot of it and it showed up a little bit different. It says sort reminders and print your lists. So this popped up for me the first time I opened Reminders. So that was something a little bit new. I also saw another splash screen that popped up in Podcasts. Now, the strange thing is it didn't pop up on every device. It only showed up on the iPhone XR for me and the 12 Pro Max, but not the iPhone 7. So when I went into Podcasts and tapped on Library, you can see it talks about shows and saved and latest episodes. So we saw this with Beta 4, and now we're seeing it again with Beta 5. This showed up for me. Now, there is another splash screen that pops up the first time you open the App Store. So if you go into the App Store, for example, and any device you go on, the App Store here, you'll get a new pop-up or a splash screen that says, welcome to the App Store. So nothing major there, but there are a few different splash screens. So as far as visual changes, there's not really anything else I was able to find between Beta 4 and Beta 5. Now, as far as known issues and resolved issues, well, in Apple's notes, they haven't really mentioned a whole lot. And you can actually see these notes if you have the beta installed, if you have iOS 15 beta or iOS 14.7, you can go to the feedback app, and under feedback, just go to inbox. So you'll go to inbox under feedback, select the one you want, and you'll see 14.7 beta 5. Now in the last one, you can see their updates for beta 4, where they restored the battery service message that may have disappeared after a reboot on some iPhone 11 models. So that was only beta 4. Now there's only one known issue listed for beta 5, and it has to do with network profiles. So you can see devices with the SKAD network developer profile installed running iOS and iPadOS 14.7 beta 3 and later can send postbacks through manually configured HTTP proxy. So it's explaining this. This doesn't seem like it's a problem. It's more of a monitoring tool, and they're just letting you know that it's there, but it is listed under known issues. That's all they've mentioned as far as this update. They have not mentioned any fixes, whether that be to green tint, for example. So green tint could still be present, but there's no way to know without people seeing it. I'm not seeing it on my device. I've checked. I haven't seen it on this, on my 12 Pro Max, for example, but with beta 4, people did message me and say that they are still seeing it. So they haven't resolved it yet, but they resolved it with the iPhone 11 series phones in August. So maybe we'll see that with a 14.7 release, or maybe a 14.7.1 or 14.8, for example. Hopefully they resolve that, but it did take them almost a year with the iPhone 11s, or 11 Pro and 11 Pro Max, for example. Now, as far as Wi-Fi, and if they've fixed the bug that's known for this, where you can actually join a network with an SSID, that's the network name, that has percent signs in it, and it will disable your network completely, and you won't be able to use it until you either reset your network settings or reset the device altogether. Let's see if that's actually fixed in iOS 14.7 beta 5. So we'll go into settings, then we'll go to Wi-Fi, and I created a network with that same SSID you'll see here. And let's go ahead and put in the password. It's just test, password, then the number 1, and we'll hit join. Let's see if we can join that network. We'll give it just a moment here. Let's see what happens. And it looks like it joined. Let's see if we can actually use the network. So we're joined to that network. We're on Apple's website. Let's learn more. And it's actually loading. So it looks like it's working properly for me now. Let me see if I can switch back to my other network and see if it's a problem. We'll go back over to my other network and it's working just fine. We'll go back in. And it looks like it's working just fine. So I can go between those networks now. That network name is not causing a problem. We'll rejoin, go back over, and it seems to be working okay. No problems here. So it looks like Apple must have fixed it in this particular update. So if we go to tech specs here for the iPhone 12, everything's working and loading as expected. So it's a good sign they finally fixed this. So I would think they'd want to push this update out pretty quickly because of that. As far as the overall heat of the device, well, so far after installing this update, rebooting, the device has cooled down quite quickly after I took them off the charger. None of them are warm at all. And actually, I just got another pop-up. You'll see that's what's new in calendar. So let's see if it's here on the other one. We'll go into calendar and it's not there. So there's a new splash screen in calendar that popped up on the 10R that says found events, time to leave, and location suggestions. That could be just because I haven't opened up calendar on the 10R for quite some time though. Now, as far as heating, like I said, it getting warm, all of these devices are nice and cool right now. Whatever issue was going on before, they've really cooled down. I have no issues. They feel cool to the touch. And even the iPhone 7 is the same thing. There might be a little bit of warmth here as it's processing some things in the background, but generally these have been nice and cool, which generally leads to better performance and battery life overall as things in the background are not processing. It's normal for them to get a little bit warm if they're processing things in the background, finishing up indexing and the updates, but in general, these are doing well. I did notice that performance does seem to be pretty good on the iPhone 7, for example. Just going through, scrolling, for example, I show the same thing. It seems nice and smooth. I show it on every different update. You'll see it's nice and smooth. With earlier betas, it wasn't so much. And with iOS 15 earlier betas, it wasn't too much. So let's see if we can wait for this to load. And it's fairly smooth just going through it. So that's a nice sign, or a good sign to overall performance. If we go into the camera, for example, it comes up nice and quick and we can snap a picture. So performance seems to be quite good. Now on the iPad, let's take a look at that. With iPadOS 14.7 beta 5, everything seems to be okay as well, although don't expect any major changes other than what I've already talked about. The splash screens are not showing up in this version on the iPad for me for some reason. But again, if we go into music, for example, takes a moment to load. The menus are a little bit choppy to begin with as things load in the background, but it is one of the older devices. So this should just give you a general idea of what to expect. It's a little bit choppy, but it does run it okay. Now, I did run Geekbench on all of these. We'll take a look at those in just a moment, but I did want to go over battery life overall first. And battery life is pretty good for most people that are using it. I had a user send in their battery life since they use it 100% of the time. I've been using iOS 15 betas 100% of the time on my other iPhone 12 Pro Max. So because I've been using that, it's great to have some people send those in so we can get a better understanding since they can use it 100% of the time. So you can see here is the battery life he sent over. So you'll see today he's had 3 hours and 33 minutes of screen on time, 1 hour and 20 minutes of screen off time, and has not even used 50%. That's on a 12 Pro Max. If we look at the next day, you'll see he used used almost 80% and had 8 hours and 1 minute of screen on time, 8 hours and 54 minutes of screen off time. And that's a huge amount of battery usage, and he'd probably get about 2 to 3 hours more. So that's pretty good. And then again, similar usage on another day, 7 hours and 23 minutes, 1 hour and 24 minutes. And again, about 80% usage of battery. And that brings you to about 10 hours of screen on time, 10 to 12 hours of screen on time, which is great. Most people that are using iOS 14.7 are not complaining of battery issues. They're saying it's fairly stable, and it should be. We're almost a year later after iOS 14.7. Now let's take a look at the Geekbench scores. So we'll go into Geekbench here, and I did run it twice since the scores were a little bit low. The first time it was probably processing in the background, but you can see on the 12 Pro Max, I scored 1,587 for single core, 4,061 for multi-core. If we go into the history, now I did wipe this device for a different video, but you can see the prior times it was run, it's doing pretty good. It's over 4,000 for multi-core score, and single core is quite good as well. So generally it's performing well. I don't typically see this single core over 1600 too often. Once in a while I will. Now let's take a look at all of these devices. Now from left to right, I have the iPad Air 2, then the iPhone 7, then the iPhone XR, and then the iPhone 12 Pro Max. And again, this is just to give you a general idea of what your scores would be like if you run it right after installing the beta. They generally improve within a couple hours as all of the background processing is finished. Now, as far as iOS 14.7 release candidate, well, we've seen them release it the next day in the past, so it could come as soon as tomorrow or sometime next week. Generally, they're on a weekly cycle, so if they do release the release candidate early next week, we could see a public release later next week. So that's kind of what I'm looking for. But if we don't see a release candidate for a couple weeks at this point, Apple has been changing it up quite a bit, but usually between the last beta and a release candidate is within days to a week. So it wouldn't surprise me if we see it late next week with maybe the final version the following week or both next week. But again, there's no way to know for sure as Apple has not told anyone directly. Now this is true also with iOS 15 beta 3, for example, and public beta 3. Many people are asking when to expect that. I would expect that either as soon as tomorrow, so it would be a week from the previous one, or it would be the following week. They generally don't go over 2 weeks or 15 days maximum between betas. In the past, that's with iOS 14, for example, and iOS 13. Now they could change it, but that's generally what I would expect. So expect some sort of beta next week, I would think. If we don't, that would be quite surprising, at least from iOS 15. They could push it to the following week, but it would surprise me if it wasn't next week. Now, as far as should you install iOS 14.7 betas, I would say at this point, they're fairly stable. If you're on 14.6 and you want to try out 14.7, I haven't seen too many issues with anything regarding that. Now, a few people are always going to have problems as there's millions of devices, but generally if you have a backup and you have a computer so you can downgrade if you need to, I would say absolutely go ahead and try 14.7 at this point. As far as iOS 15, you might want to wait until beta 3 is available. Since it's the second public beta, that's generally when I recommend most people try iOS 15 if you're worried about major bugs and things like that. So look forward to all of those things coming very, very soon, hopefully as soon as early next week. But again, Apple can change that, so just keep that in mind. If you'd like to get your hands on this wallpaper, of course, I'll link it in the description like I normally do. And if you haven't subscribed already, please subscribe. And if you enjoyed the video, please give it a like. As always, thanks for watching. This is Aaron. I'll see you next time.